is Tammy DeBruns from Master Control at WPLG-TV in South Florida. I've been here for 33 years, and you are watching the NAB show live.
Live from Las Vegas, this is NAB Show Live, produced by Broadcast Beat.
I'm Amy DeLuise, and this is my co-host, Adrian Ashley. And you are watching us here on Gals and Gear Special on NAB Show Live. Yeah.
Yay, let's hear it.
We got a live show.
We got a live audience.
We got a live audience. And thank you to Women in Film and Video. We are bringing you women in the industry, leaders who are demoing the best creative and tech here at NAB Show. We are streaming live on BroadcastBeat.com. And NABShow.com, so you can follow along. And we're going to bring you some exclusive content on our Broadcast Beat YouTube channel. So follow us throughout the show on Broadcast Beat's Facebook page and hashtag Gals in Gear. Gals and
Gear. That's right. We'll also be live tweeting under the hashtag Gals in Gear. So please retweet us, and you'll be eligible for incredible giveaways. Everything from Adobe World tickets to the Blackmagic Micro Cinema camera that I really want for myself. So follow along and win some awesome gear, meet some amazing women, and have a great time.
Okay, so now we have our very first Gals and Gear women sitting right over here next to us. And of course, first I want to start with Adrian. Adrian started in front of the camera, and then thanks to a terrible injury, she actually came behind the camera, which is great because
she
moved behind the scenes, and that's where she really belonged. And she fell in love with orchestrating productions, and boy, is she good at that. And I can see exactly why she got into production. So since helming her first feature film, Metal, she's produced several features and won several written award-winning best-selling films and books and dominated social media. And boy, does she ever dominate social media.
Just a little bit. Just like 110 million.
Follow her on Twitter and Facebook. And she's the CEO and founder of Crowded TV, which is an incredible crowdsourcing production platform. If you're a content creator and you have a great idea for a television show, Adrian's going to help you launch that show.
CrowdedTV.net.
Exactly.
Little shout out.
And I also want to give another shout out to our sponsors, our incredible sponsors. I want to hear it from the audience for give it up for Blackmagic Design, Media Central, Broadcast Beat Magazine for inviting us on, Future Media Concepts, Adobe. We've got lots of great giveaways from these folks coming up. So follow us on hashtag Gals and Gear on Twitter, and we'll get started with the show.
So let's bring on our first guests, Megan Donnelly, a DP and camera engineer with Able Cine in their Chicago location, and Rose Fadum Johnson, a DP in Los Angeles. Welcome.
Welcome aboard.
Thank you.
Welcome. Welcome to hashtag Gals and Gear Live. So Rose, you're a narrative cinematographer. I know you specialize in effects, both digital and practical. And she holds a degree from UCLA's FTVDM and a master's degree from the American Film Institute. Very impressive. Her award-winning films have been showcased in festivals in Chicago, IFF, Toronto, Montreal, the Italian Contemporary.
Ooh,
nice. Others. So Rose, I want to start with you. How did you decide you wanted to be a cinematographer? Was there like an aha moment for you?
I wish I had an aha moment. It was really the slow realization that everything I loved in so many forms of art and also my weird kind of engineering brain could all be combined into one arena. So I fell into it and it stuck.
Awesome. I want to talk to you about shooting on film because when I started in the business a million centuries ago, we only shot on film. And so I've done loading magazines and checking the gate, and it seems to be so much vernacular that we don't use anymore. But what is it that, you know, this is a heavily digital conference, but I have spoken to more people who are like, I shoot on film. Like, what is it about film? What does it let you do shooting on film that you don't get to do shooting on digital?
I was trained on film, and I'm so glad I was, because I think it's completely changed my approach to production. The thing that film gives you, in addition to the fact that, you know, a chemical processes and a digital processes are always going to have a different feel, is much in the same way as taking a still photo, taking 30 photos on your iPhone and picking one later, versus really choosing your shot and settling on something. I think film inspires another level of pre-production and another level of forethought. And on plenty of sets, it really seems to focus people in, the taking the pauses and the necessary cadence of the set on a film set is different. And when those are implemented on digital sets, it absolutely improves those sets as well. And I mostly do shoot digital, and I love it. But there's definitely benefits to both formats.
It sounds like you can do more faster with a better end result because you have that film experience.
I feel like I can, but that doesn't mean I work faster than somebody who doesn't. I don't know. I've only been me, but I certainly appreciate the experience.
Awesome.
So, Megan, I want to bring you into this conversation. So I know you've got a background as a director of photography as well, and you've lensed commercials and music videos and narrative films, and you've won all kinds of awards like the Midwest Emmy and the New York TV Festivals Award. So how did you get from being an award-winning director of photography to a camera technology specialist at Abel Cine?
Well, it's been a good journey, I have to say. I got into the business. I started with film as well. I'm really thankful that I have that background, and then I got into the business right when digital cinematography was really taking off. So I worked with Local 600 and traveled across the country to teach film loaders how to do digital loading. So that's how I got into digital cinematography, worked for Rental House to learn all the technical side I could, and now I work for Able to teach that to other people as well as shoot myself.
So I see you brought us a really fun toy, and unfortunately, and I apologize, we don't get to fly it. We could not pull permits to fly it, and I was so wanting to do a drone shot of all these wonderful people here in the audience.
And they've actually brought another camera with them, and tell us a little bit about the camera that you set up.
Yeah, I actually brought the Arri Alexa Mini over. We have that at the Able Cine booth. It's one of many cameras that I shoot with. I like to pick the right tool for the job. I think that's really important, actually, with digital cinematography. But of course, the Alexa Mini is a beautiful camera. It also has a Teradek color box on it, which is a wireless LUT control. And LUT workflow is a really, you know, challenging but also creative environment. So I really like that workflow.
So I'm curious, this is really a question for both of you. You've shot a lot of films. Does it make a difference when there's a woman DP? Do you gravitate towards films that have women protagonists? Does it change the environment on the set? Is it completely irrelevant? I'm just curious, you know, is there an it factor? Is there something that happens when there's a woman DPing a film? Because there's certainly been some studies like the Celluloid Ceiling Report, which came out last year, talking about when women are at the helm of a project, there tend to be more women protagonists with more lines. But I'm curious, just your personal experience, maybe that doesn't play for you?
I think there's two elements to that, right? There's women in development and the effect, because DPs are also involved in pre-production,
sure, exactly.
The effect that has. And then there's also the set environment. And at the end of the day, you know, gender isn't definitive of personality, so you can't give one blanket answer of, oh, with a female DP, everything will go more smoothly. I mean, I'd love to say that if you decide to hire me, but more to the point. With a female DP, you might end up with somebody who's more aware in the hiring process. And with a more gender-balanced set, I have actually experienced more gender-balanced sets as working more smoothly because you just have a variation of personality types, a variation of communication styles. And the more communication styles you have, the more likely you are going to be able to successfully communicate. In pre-production and development, I mean, I've definitely found that as a DP, I can kind of notice things or encourage things in terms of, oh, let's think about this from another perspective, that maybe if the entire pre-production team is all from the same background, they wouldn't have seen. Right. But for the most part, I'm not involved in that.
Right. How about you, Megan?
No, I think that's a good point. I used to think there wasn't any difference, or I wouldn't think about what other women were in the production. Mm-hmm. But as I've worked more, especially with female producers, I do think there's a different type of communication that happens. And I really enjoy, I work with a lot of male directors actually, and working with them and coming up with maybe more creative ways to create their vision.
The more variety of people you have, and it's not limited to gender,
right?
The more types of input you have, and I think then the more successful your product can be.
Okay, you're gonna wrap it up.
I agree. So we could talk to you guys all day long, we totally could, but thank you, Rose and Megan, for taking the time out of your crazy. Has it been crazy? There's 120,000 people here. It is a crazy show schedules here. And to be with us on Gals and Gears, this segment of NAB Show Live. Please, everyone, follow #GalsandGear. hashtag Gals and Gears, and we've got a big giveaway coming up, so we'll be right back.
Thank you. All right. Thank you. You guys can have, all right.
Are we good?
So coming up next, we have an amazing Gals and Gear woman to show us some fun with drones, my dear friend and colleague, Louisa Casanova-Winters. Welcome.
Thank you.
Woo! Give it up for Louisa.
Hi.
Louisa, I know.
Okay, Louisa, I know that you're an award-winning director and producer, a certified Adobe and certified Apple instructor, and also an accomplished violinist.
I am. I am. I went to school for classical violin, and I have my degree in music performance.
Wonderful. And speaking of Adobe, we have an Adobe Cloud subscription coming up as our next giveaway, so watch that hashtag, and hashtag Gals and Gear if you want to get in on the giveaways.
Yeah. All right, so Louisa, tell me, I'm kind of fascinated by the fact that you have a pilot's license. Do we have a picture of Louisa in her plane? Do we have a shot of her in her plane?
Well, that's my laptop.
Oh, okay.
Let me start playing some of my. There you go.
Oh, okay.
Some of my videos.
Oh, okay. But I wanted to say, what I'm really fascinated about is how you got into shooting drones. Like, how did that come about?
Well,
because you're an Adobe trainer.
So I am an Adobe
trainer. What was that connection?
So I've been a videographer, let's put it that way, for about 30 years, and I've always been addicted to gadgets. You know, if there's a cool gadget, I will go out and buy it. So about 2 years ago, I discovered that there was this wonderful thing that had propellers and flew and took pictures. So I had to get one, and one turned into eight. And eight.
She's a gal with a lot of gear.
And
that is a gal with a lot of gear.
And
eight
of those. I love gadgets. I just love gadgets. I am a really addicted. My poor husband. So, you know, but I can turn down the music.
That would be awesome.
I love it. I want to hear you.
I just want to make sure that they can hear you.
Right.
Now, my question is, being a pilot, does it make it easier to fly drones? That's the big controversy is what... Right. What it is about, you know, you having to get a license in order to fly
Correct.
A drone, and we just started a drone flight school in Reno for that very...
Yeah, so, right. You know, one of the things that I was misinformed about was that I had heard that in order to get a commercial exemption to fly the drones, you had to be a pilot. So I'm like, okay, if that's what it takes, that's what I'm going to do. So I started flying school, and I became a pilot about maybe 7-8 months ago. And then shortly after starting my training, I discovered that no, you don't need to be a pilot to get your commercial exemption. But I loved it so much that I continued flying, right? And now I'm going for other certifications. I'm going for instrument certification, commercial certification, with the big drone that, you know, you ride inside of.
Oh,
you nice. Do your, so yeah. And eventually, because I am a trainer, I want to become a flight instructor. To answer your question, what is the correlation between flying a drone and flying a plane, I gotta be honest with all of you, absolutely none.
Well, that's good to know. That means we're going to have more ability to have drone pilots,
Woo.
Which is amazing because I know my husband went through flight school. My former husband went through flight school and flies a tail dragger. So that's
nice.
He tries to kill you every time you land.
Oh,
so
absolutely.
I know the flight school's crazy.
But there is one thing that I did learn as a pilot. When you are up in the air and you're flying a plane, I was totally misinformed until I started flying. The biggest danger that we pilots face are other aircraft. In other words, if a drone is flying near my plane, I'm going to be really freaked out. Reason for the rules that are in place by the FAA. And even though before becoming a pilot, I was like, yeah. Now I'm like, yeah.
I would like to encourage everyone to learn to fly. I think it's a national pastime that I think is not popular enough. You can join the Civil Air Patrol. They'll take
Absolutely.
You up on flights. All these things. And it'll help you with the whole idea of visualizing what you could do with a drone. Because you're up there in the plane and you're like, wow, that's a nice angle.
Absolutely. And right? Less than 6% of the pilots in the U.S. are women. And, you know, we have women, we have such a long history of aviation. Just think Amelia Earhart, right? So brave, so fantastic. And, you know, other than, obviously, you know, income inequality and all of that, there is no reason why a woman can't fly. It doesn't require, you know, upper body strength or whatever. And let me tell you, once you fly, it's like the best psychiatrist you've ever been to. When you are flying, you cannot concentrate on your problems. Your problems are left behind. You are just flying. So, yeah, I moved up, stepped up from my gadgets to a really big gadget that I can be inside and take up.
So, speaking of the gadgets, talk to us a little bit about what kind of cameras do you fly on your drones?
So I fly different cameras because I have different drones, and I use them for different things, right? So most of them are 4K cameras. I am now working on giving a great experience to this little orange guy here. And the camera that it has is 4K. It shoots unbelievable color. You can eventually, if you change the camera, shoot RAW with it, REC 709, whatever you want. And the compression schemes on these for the video have gotten unbelievable. Of course, if you want a better camera with better lens, then you need a bigger drone that will support the payload of the weight, right? But let me tell you, for regular corporate work, which is what I use these mostly, these little guys are perfect. Perfect. They're easy to manage. They connect to the satellite systems. If you just stop moving the controls and they are being connected to the satellite, they'll just hover in place, even if there is wind. And that is something to be said. They are stable. They are fantastic. And like I said, extremely easy to use.
Okay, great.
Awesome.
So before you go, I think we're going to give something away on our segment. Do we want to do a couple of giveaways? Are people tweeting?
Are you tweeting? Hashtag? We're going to give you a couple of seconds here.
Give you a couple seconds.
Hashtag gals and gear. What is your favorite segment piece so far? What are you most interested in? What do you do in the industry? Introduce yourselves. We are in the process of picking a winner via the hashtag. So if you have not tweeted into the hashtag, you're not eligible.
Also, take a picture of yourself with our button.
Yes.
If you have a button, take a picture of yourself with our button. But we have some giveaways. Let's give away a t-shirt. We have a fabulous Gals in Gear t-shirt.
Oh, that's awesome.
I mean, look at this.
I think it should be whoever jumps up and yells the loudest.
Who wants a Gals in Gear t-shirt?
Come on up. Yeah.
Woo!
Yay! Okay, that's the first one.
All right. All right, we also have, from our friends at FMC, Future Media Concepts, some friends of ours who are running lots of classes today over in post-production world. We have a fabulous FCPX Creative Summit giveaway. This is worth $895. It's October 27th through 30th in Cupertino, California. Do we have any Final Cut?
We're gonna wait a moment for that because I have to get the link.
Okay.
So that's on my laptop.
So tweet away. Talk to your friends if they want to have a Final Cut giveaway. We're gonna give that away next. Okay.
Okay. So I think, you know, that was awesome. I love the inspiration to fly. Amy, we are definitely hanging out with the cool kids today.
Yeah, we are.
I love it.
We're gonna wrap up this segment.
And
we're gonna see a little bit of a PanaFlasher technology demo. With a couple of other in-camera techniques from the women that we met earlier, Megan and Rose.
That's awesome.
We will see you back shortly on Gals in Gear Live.
Hashtag Gals in Gear. Join us. We are in Studio One, broadcast beat in the Central Hall. If you are at NAB Show, please join us. If you wish you were at NAB Show, please tweet us.
Hi, I'm cinematographer Marianne Williams at Panavision Hollywood with engineer Tom Kenyon and fellow DP Rose Fatum Johnson to test the Panavision PanaFlasher 3.0. This is a filter system designed to give practical and creative look control to the color and levels of your digital cinematography. It's portable and easy to use. The total case size is only 8 inches by 3.5 inches. Essentially, it's a 6x6 low contrast filter rimmed with 64 tiny LEDs that have adjustable RGB channels and a master luminance slider. The touchscreen also has a setting for color balance, which offsets the master Kelvin of the LEDs. The RGB arrows adjust the channels one point at a time, from value 0 to 100. First, let's see how the PanaFlasher performs when adjusting just the red, green, and blue channels from 0 to 100. Affecting mostly the lift and gamma, the PanaFlasher brings up shadow values and fills them with color, from a subtle wash to nearly opaque pastel, depending on your settings. We tested the PanaFlasher with various lenses, both modern and vintage, to see how it would interact with lens flares. Craig Boydston stopped in with a custom Dior net filter that fits into a standard 4x5 filter tray. Here we can see the filter off and on. The stocking diffuses the light and does beautiful work on the skin. In a stroke of brilliance, Rose cooked up this look with the Dior net in combination with the PanaFlasher. She left the matte box open, so the PanaFlasher is only affecting the right edge of the frame. Next, we went outside into the Panavision parking lot to see how the PanaFlasher performs in natural light. Rose and I were operating the camera and PanaFlasher together, changing the color and luminance while the camera is panning and tilting. We were interested in trying some big creative looks, but the PanaFlasher can also be used for subtle adjustments, dialing in color or density changes to the point. It also is a tool to match two cameras when camera and lens combos are different during a two-camera shoot or reshoot situation.
This is Nicole D. I'm the director of CBS Community Partnerships at WTOG-TV in Tampa, Florida. You're watching NAB Show Live, produced by Broadcast Beat.
Live from Las Vegas, this is NAB Show Live, produced by Broadcast Beat.
All right,
and welcome back to another segment of Gals and Gear Live, coming to you from Broadcast Beat Studio One here in the Las Vegas Convention Center. We are in the Central Hall. This is NAB Show. You should be here. We are streaming on BroadcastBeat.com, NABShow.com, and we are giving away some amazing stuff. Tweet into the hashtag Gals and Gear, and we have a winner.
We do.
We have a winner.
Okay, right. Stand by. We've got a Final Cut FCPX Creative Summer giveaway, free
pass.
It's a
value of $895. Woo! And I'm hoping...
Who's the lucky winner?
I'm hoping that Doug Dalton is here and not on the floor. If you are here, stand up, give us a little happy dance.
Is Doug Dalton here?
If you are not, we will write your name on it and tweet you that you won. Okay? I want to give another shout out to our sponsors. We have some amazing, great giveaways for you.
All right, good. Can we see our sponsor names one more time? Do we have a little sponsor sheet there that we can show? I want to mention that Broadcast Beat was so generous to invite us, Black Magic Camera, which is going to do a big giveaway soon. Media Central, Future Media Concepts, and Adobe are our top sponsors. Fabulous. We're so excited to have them. All right, so I want to welcome to our set Cheryl Ottenritter. Cheryl is amazing. privilege that I get to mix my shows with her, so I couldn't really do a Gals and Gear show without Cheryl.
But first, we want to give away a 3-month Creative Cloud subscription from Adobe, each worth $150, and I'm going to pick another winner here.
Ooh,
and
Adobe
the other
Creative
winner
Cloud.
Is...
Somebody have a pen I need to write down.
Glasses would be good, but you know, it's not good for my ego, so I didn't wear them. I think that says April Hamilton. Yay!
All right, April.
We have a handout.
We'll bring it to you afterwards.
We're going to bring it to you afterwards, but congratulations, April Hamilton.
Don't forget, we'll come right to you, and we'll give you your little code for download, okay?
Doug Dalton, if you are in the building, if you are listening to us streaming, you can come up and get it. Otherwise, it will be here at Studio One for you later.
Okay.
Awesome.
Right. Now, back to Cheryl.
Back to Cheryl. That's quite
you
all right.
You had to give away free stuff.
That's better
what
than,
can we
yes,
do?
Free stuff is good.
All right, and we're going to give away some free stuff after Cheryl, too. So Cheryl is the senior mixer and founder of Odd House Audio. She has mixed projects for PBS, National Geographic, Smithsonian Channel, Discovery, TV One, and me. So that's awesome. So I'm just curious, Cheryl, I know you were bitten by the music bug. You know,
yes.
We just had Louisa Winters on, who's a violinist. And so tell me, what instrument do you play?
Well, currently I just play piano.
Okay.
And I have two degrees in music, music theory and composition and jazz studies. And I was, in my previous life, I played gigs at night, jazz trio, big band, stuff like that.
Oh, cool.
And then I fell into audio because people kept on asking me to write, compose for their film or compose for their theater project or whatever, and I had no idea what I was doing. So I just started hanging out in studios and found out I was a better engineer than I was composer.
Wow.
Wow. So you're on top of all the latest and greatest tools, but I have to ask you, is it hard in sound design? Is it tough to be a woman in this business, and how can we get more women qualified to do this?
It is tough. It's getting easier. Like everything else, we're opening up doors all the time. But, you know, long time ago when I first started, only 2% were females in the business, in the sound business and audio post and sound designing.
Wait, did you just say
2%?
2%.
2%. That sounds like milk.
Yeah, just like milk. And so now I think it's much more, like maybe 5%. But in L.A., it's much, much bigger than in any place else in the country. But it is harder, and I think it's just everybody needs to mentor more and be involved in bringing up young people, whether they're male or female, and teach them that it doesn't matter what your gender is in the business, it's how good you are. And just keep mentoring and helping young people grow in sound is really what you should be doing.
So I'm curious if you have any like fun things to show us. I hear you have a little Isotope action going on here.
Oops. I'm a big fan of Isotope. They are all the time. I use them every day. Every day in the suite, I use them. I clean up audio all the time with it. I can't even imagine my life without it.
Can you explain for those people in our studio audience and our out in the world audience what Isotope is? Is it a plug-in?
It's an
tool?
Audio.
What is it?
Right, it's an audio tool company. They have lots of different tools, EQs, compressors, reverbs. The one I use the most is the RX, which is the restoration, and noise restoration and noise reduction software. Okay. And it comes on board in Audition and in your Adobe suite too. So a lot of tools. But the one I want to show is the D-Clip, because you can actually see it as well as
hear it. It might be a little hard to hear out here.
Exactly. So I thought ahead on that. As you can see, this is highly distorted. You don't even have to hear it, but I'm going to go ahead and play it.
The largest broadcasting deal in Major League Baseball history was announced.
Oh, that's ugly.
Very ugly. You can see it's
it
a buzz cut.
It even looks ugly.
It looks
really
ugly.
It looks very
so
ugly and
what
tuppy.
You can do is just select all. Let's see if I can do that.
Usually Control-A.
Yeah.
Pretty much universally in the entire world.
And then
world.
Go to D-Clip. And I already have it set up for high quality and going to get in there and dig in and go ahead and process it. And you'll see right away what will happen. And if you close...
Whoa.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, wow.
You suddenly have audio that's
good.
Real. It's like, looks like waveforms, right? I'm going to play it for you.
Okay.
Oh, if it lets me. There we go.
History was announced on Tuesday. MLB
hard to hear. That's why I chose it, because you can actually see the waveforms being
but I mean, I can hear the difference.
But the difference is like, it's like, 2% milk to whole milk.
Yeah.
Well, like, really different.
I try to avoid showing this to clients, but I just broke my own rule. So now they think we can fix anything.
Right, right. Yeah. I know. Don't tell.
I have had some really ugly audio that could not be fixed.
So I'm curious, Cheryl, because, you know, one of the things that we were talking about in some of my classes yesterday in post-production world was that a lot of us are producing for multiple platforms, right?
Right.
So we're producing for, like, big, big screens at live events.
Yeah.
Then we're producing for broadcast, and then all of a sudden we got to be producing for mobile devices. Is there a difference in the audio across those, and do you treat the audio differently when you know what the platform is?
Absolutely. Especially if it's cross-platform. I used to actually deliver different mixes. When I found out was I was too complicated for people and it went too many places and wrong. So what I do is for live events and web and different things like that, I do minus six. Non-broadcast is minus six, straight across. And then I figure out if it's mono, stereo, multi-channel. You know, I haven't mixed in Atmos yet, but, you know, 7.1, et cetera. And then, but for broadcast, it really is your network. Your network tells you how to mix. Oh, and right now the government tells you how to mix, too, with LKFS and the Calm Act and stuff like that. So
I'm not sure I want the government in my creativity.
Actually, it's made me more creative. I found that it gave me more dynamic range for my mixes. I could go lower, I could go hotter, and I could turn around to the client and go, I can't make that hotter. It won't pass QC.
Oh,
so it's good.
Nice. It was kind of like the bad cop.
Nice.
So it, I was the same way. I was like, yeah, I don't want them telling me how to mix. And then I got into it, and it actually made me a better mixer.
Do you have any fun projects coming up at Odd House Audio? Anything cool you want to tell us about or you're allowed to tell us
that
about?
That I can talk about?
That you can talk about.
There's a couple things I can talk about, but there's a documentary I get to mix when I get back for the Little Rock 9 for the Park Service.
Oh, cool.
And we're doing most of the audio for the African American Museum, which is a lot of fun.
Wow, that's a brand new big installation.
Yeah,
so that's
and some of that will be multi-channel. Some of that will be just kiosk audio. And then I'm also doing a documentary for the Smithsonian Channel this month as well.
Fantastic.
Nice.
Well, I hear that you brought us a giveaway from our friends at Izotope.
They're so kind.
Wow. Yes.
I'm very excited.
And tell us
what's
included here.
This is RX Audio Editor. It does everything
it
I just showed
my jacket.
You. Yes, it just shows you. And it
coordinates with mine.
Lots of different things, denoise, declip, dehum, de-whatever.
We give away two.
And it's awesome.
I have two.
Are we
maybe
giving
we
away
give
two?
Away two.
Okay. Give away two.
All right, why don't we give away one to somebody in our live studio audience? Is there anybody here who would just
Well, I can pick the first name.
Oh.
I know that that is just not enough excitement
to
give away this fantastic product.
Awesome.
I want to see some huge excitement. And not that I want to train you to run up to the desk and get it, but maybe that would work. I'm just saying. There we go. Maybe that would work.
All right, and we want to give one away to somebody who's tweeting to the hashtag gals in gear.
Yeah, it's in 4-point font, and I'm not wearing glasses, so I'm going to butcher this. But the first name is Maria. Is there a Maria here?
And they're in the South Hall if you want
Maria!
To.
Maria! And the avatar looks exactly like you. So.
Excellent.
Thank you for not making me butcher your name.
All right. Well, I just want to thank Cheryl
again
for coming on Gals in Gear. Give it up for
Yay!
Cheryl.
Yay! Okay.
Right. And next.
For our next segment, we've got an amazing woman who works as the senior finishing artist for Light Iron. Welcome to hashtag Gals in Gear, Katie Hinson.
All right, so Katie, I know you have a killer resume. You have a background in offline and online editing and visual effects, stereoscopic 3D and color. I know you worked your way up in the TV and film industry in New Zealand before being a DI editor on Knowing, The Lovely Bones, which is like one of my favorite books and movies, and Don't Be Afraid of the Dark. Katie was also part of the Oscar-nominated team for Best Achievement in Film Editing. Wow. And
on
Best
District
Achievement
9.
In Visual Effects on District 9, which is awesome. So,
I think we need to pause.
Yeah, exactly.
Seriously.
So, and now she's in New York with Light Iron. So I'm just curious, like, what are some of the projects that you're working on now that you're allowed to speak about? I know there's some that are top secret.
I know. What is this with the top secret? It's Gals in Gear. We're, like, here to share. And,
right.
But there's all this top secret stuff. It's like spy stuff.
Because we don't want to put spoilers out there.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the thing. So at Light Iron New York, we do feature films mostly, and we also do high-end television commercials. But you know, a lot of what we're doing in New York is what is done in New York, which is my favorite stuff to do. It's like independent features, festival kind of stuff. I love it so much. So that's kind of, we've got Tribeca actually film festival going on right now in New York. Right? I do a bit of visual effects work. I do a lot of retouching, which is the stuff that we're not allowed to talk about.
Right. That's making people look good on camera.
Yeah.
So let me ask, just in general, because I know you didn't do this one, but is it in the vein of we had to spend an extra $10 million to make Kevin Costner have hair in Waterworld?
That's the sort of thing I do.
Got it. So I understand these are celebrity contracts where they're like, look, I am not allowed to have cellulite.
Yeah. Right.
Period.
Yeah. Right. And you know, that sort of thing is very real. And that sort of thing does encompass not just people making, you know, stars look 10 years younger.
Right.
It also...
But it's in my contract.
Yeah. It also encompasses a lot of other things. Like, in period pieces, we have to fix, you know, all kinds of things that you didn't see in production. But as soon as you start, you know, you can form everything, you bring it up into a 6K projection, you put a bit of contrast into it, and you go, oh my God, look at that. I never saw that before. And that's when they call me.
So you're like a firefighter.
I'm the definition of fix it in post.
Right.
You know, that's a big part of what I do.
Right.
But I also do a lot of the technical things. I coach the team through bringing things into post, you know. And right from really early on in the production, it's really cool to have the filmmakers come in and I'll say, okay, tell us about what you're shooting. Tell us about what you want to do with it. Let me give you some advice and tell you what we can do, what we can't do, maybe the best way, some little tips and the best way to get something into post really smoothly, really efficiently.
Yeah.
And then out the other side, passing QC with flying colors.
Right. Yeah. Well, I'm fascinated by this. I actually started my career working on Forrest Gump, mm-hmm. doing art department research and working with ILM, mm-hmm. you know, handing off those files. And so I kind of understood what you do, but not really at the time. I was like tiny and young and knew nothing.
And now you are, am I allowed to say badass?
Yeah.
She's badass.
She is so, we did not get to talk about, 2 seconds.
Okay.
Yes.
This woman is amazing. Gals and Gear was her idea. You know, it's like the one time when we come to an event and there's 120,000 people here and there's never a line in the ladies' room.
Yes,
and it pissed her off. And she was like, we need more ladies. We need to celebrate the ladies. We need to celebrate the women behind. And this is her baby. This is her dream. She has done an amazing job putting this entire production together and gathering all of these amazing women for us to interview. Right. And I just wanted
so kind. So listen, let me bring another amazing lady into this conversation because Jillian Arnold has been sitting here patiently. And she is, you know, she said to me before she came on, you know, Amy, I'm not really supposed to be in the post segment because I'm a video engineer. And she's actually a video engineer with a master's in film production and cinematography from Chapman University. I don't know, do we have a picture of Jillian with all of her stuff? I don't know if we have that backstage. But I know that you're also Pranology's first operator.
I am, and I'm here representing
Which is
them.
Amazing.
Yeah.
So the reason, and I also wanted her to come on the show because, you know, we've been talking about 2% women here and 3% women here. She is a member of IA Local 695, and I believe she's one of like two women in the position of video engineer in the entire country, which
I am,
is
yes.
kind of like, what?
No.
So we're hoping that more women and young women might even know what this job is, so she's going to talk a little bit about it. And the reason I brought her on the post segment is because really nothing that Katie does could happen if there's not a Jillian managing the terabytes of data
awesome
that get from
the
production into post.
Yeah.
So there's like a handoff, and here it is. Here's the handoff. So, you know, she makes sure that millions of dollars worth of footage don't get lost by the wayside. So I'm just curious.
I have lost that footage before.
Yeah, and I know that you've worked on some really cool projects like FIFA Women's World Cup and Fox's Utopia. So I'm just curious, is there a key to like not missing a single file when there are literally bazillions of files? How do you do it?
It's called no sleep. And I have to be just extremely meticulous about my work. and where everything is, and I may have to make sure that I set myself up with a great team so that we can handle all those files and get them from production all the way into post.
Do you have a special naming convention? I know when I was doing that and I literally had, you know, 80 terabytes in a week. And everything had to be, do you have like a trick to naming it? Because I know the first day was not the same as what the last day was. And I had to rewatch everything to figure it out.
Every project I go on, we have this discussion. We naming convention, how the files are going to be organized, the metadata that goes to and from post. It's really unique to every single project, and that's partly why I like to come on so early, is so that we develop that architecture and make sure that it fits everyone's needs in production.
So, Katie, when somebody like Jillian is handing those files to you, do you actually like have phone conversations at the start of production?
Absolutely.
How often are you talking during production? Is there like a weekly meeting, a daily meeting? How do you make sure, like, if something got changed and like we thought it was going to need the sign out, but now we need this other thing out? How does that happen?
For me, it's all about what post needs.
Yeah.
And I'll however they want those files organized and they can find them quickly, I'll make sure that that's implemented.
And for me, it's actually about having a really good relationship with production so that they feel they can call me as often as they want. One thing that I always try, my big PSA is, if you have questions about handing over to finishing and post, the only person you should ask that question to is the person doing your finishing and post.
Absolutely.
And the reason is that just because you have done a turnover to one studio or one artist doesn't mean it's going to be the same for the next one.
I've never had two projects that are the same.
Right.
Never.
And so I really like to make myself, and this is something that we do at LightIron, we really like to make ourselves like very approachable, because it's like you can call me at 3 in the morning if you have a question, because I'd rather you do. Right. And I think it's
really, yeah. Right. I can tell you just from interacting with you on this show, Katie was really like, she was texting me in the middle of the night and we were making sure we had her demo reel. So I can imagine if I were handing terabytes of data to you that I would have to be having those conversations.
But the thing is that, you know, for filmmakers, you know, we seem like a small cog in the wheel, but, you know, they have a lot on their plates. You know, people that actually make the films have so much to think about and do. And we, you know, there is this whole concept of front of house and back of house and post.
Right.
And we like to make the filmmakers feel very comfortable and make sure that all they need to worry about is being creative.
Right.
So it's up to people like Jillian and I to do all that legwork and to talk amongst ourselves and to make sure that the filmmakers don't have to worry about anything but being creative.
That's my philosophy on
set
too. If I can take that pressure off of the director, off of the producers, you know, it's all going into the same creative experience, and I totally agree with that statement.
Speaking of pressure, I understand you worked with NASA's Jet Propulsion Labs. How about that for pressure?
So cool. Yeah.
And coolness.
I've been with them.
Ups the cool factor.
Yeah, I've been with them for about 9 years. I've done probably 14 or 15 missions. I am a video technician for the Jet Propulsion Lab. I started off doing live broadcasts like this, and my craving for the technical really brought me into very specialized shooting. So I shoot major engineering tests for the Mars program, and you know,
Mars.
So
yeah, how cool is that?
So high pressure in the.
That is so cool. We have the best gals.
We have the best gals. Just by, you know, a show of applause. Do you guys think we should be like doing this all the time at all the conventions? I think this is awesome.
All right.
We are running out of time.
We are.
We are.
We're going to have to give more stuff away.
Oh, my God. We have to give more stuff away.
I think we have to give more stuff. We have a bunch of stuff to give away.
Okay, you pull the stuff out. I'll pull the people.
Okay.
I'm using a random tweet draw. So it might pick the same people twice. So if I've already called you and I don't remember, which happens, tell me.
Wait, let me see.
What is
our next? All right, we've got a couple things. Sorry.
What are we giving away next?
All right, so this may not sound like a big deal, but Boom Cosmetics was created by a woman who had been a model, and she's now created this company, and all they do is create these little sticks, because none of us have time for like 85 million cosmetics, and if you travel a lot like I do, you cannot carry all your liquids with you.
Right.
So everything that Boom makes are these little sticks. It's just a stick that you use on your cheeks and you're done. It works on your lips too. It's like multitasking.
Awesome.
So they have given us three of these $75 giveaways, and I can't wait to have a little packet from them. So if anybody wants their Boom Cosmetics, we are going to give three of these away.
First one is April Hamilton.
April, are you here?
April, are you here?
Is she here?
She already called?
Okay.
Okay, awesome. Okay, and our next one.
Excellent.
Is not Adobe After Effects. Has to be a person, by the way, not a brand, right, to win. That's right.
Sorry, Adobe, you can't have the makeup.
Yes, you can't have the makeup. And we have a lot of brands tweeting into Gals and Gear. I think they like us.
Yeah.
I think they do. So if you want to win, you should be tweeting. I do not see enough phones out there.
Now, another cool thing that I have to give away is I have this Rampant Design download, 2K or 4K, product of choice, Rampant Design. We interviewed their CFO the other day, Stephanie Millen. And we want to give this away. Who wants a Rampant
Nora
Design?
Nora Abansky. Nora, are you here? Yay! Come on up.
You can come get that when we're done. I'll have it here for you.
Okay. So we have to go quick. Okay. We have to go quick.
We got an Adobe Video World Pass. Woo! This is worth a lot of money, $1,695 from FMC. Thank you, FMC.
Thank you, FMC. Is Nestor in the house?
Woo! I'm going to give that to you right now. Come on up.
Come on up and get that.
All right, and then we have our final big giveaway.
We should just give it to me.
We have a bunch of Vimeo Pro accounts. I think we're going to have to do that offline because we got to wrap up. I got
Rachel socks.
All right, Rachel, let's give Rachel a Vimeo Pro account.
Rachel, are you here? Rachel socks.
Are you
Valerio?
Here?
Oh,
good.
And somebody's writing down all these winners because I'm hitting refresh and it's picking new ones.
Okay. I don't know what that is. Oh, come here.
Oh, Iographer. Iographer. I live in this thing.
How many minutes do
we have left? It's so good. We have like 1 minute. It's super, super fast.
If you're not a
Rachel Borgen. Borgen.
Do you use your iPhone to shoot movies? Because then you want this Iographer package.
It is so amazing.
Cool.
It's awesome. So Rachel Borgen. Borgen.
Rachel, are you here?
Are you here?
Rachel, come on.
I almost think you're here.
Come on.
Okay, good, because I'm like, must be present to win these big ones. Seriously,
now,
I want it on camera.
This is our best one.
Oh,
my God. Who does not want this beautiful? I really want this camera. It's too bad I'm tethered to a microphone. I just walk right off with it. It's a little Blackmagic micro camera worth $995.
It
also,
is amazing.
Can I just say shout out to Blackmagic for the coffee and donuts?
Yes. Woo! We have our winner. So, are you ready?
Yes.
Brittany Flynn.
Brittany,
is Brittany in the house?
Where's Brittany? You have to be present.
I think you have to be present to win this one. Am I going to hit refresh? I hitting refresh?
Uh-oh.
Refresh?
Right.
We have like seconds to go.
Come on, guys. We need to wrap it up. We need to give this away. Hurry up.
Shelby Hagensmith.
Shelby, are you here? Oh, come on. You can't give it to her.
Randomly did.
I don't think so, but we'll talk about that.
I think that's really
all right.
Okay, we're going to wrap up.
We are going to wrap up. Thank you very much for being with us on Gals and Gear. We want to give a shout out to all of our sponsor names. Want to mention that Broadcast Beat was so generous to invite us, Blackmagic Camera, Media Central, Future Media Concepts, and Adobe are our top sponsors. Fabulous. We're so excited to have us.
Hi, I'm Christine Steele, and we are at NAB in Las Vegas. I'm here with Gals and Gear. I'd like to introduce you to Lucy Seaborn, the Senior Application Specialist for Quantel Rio, and we're going to learn a little bit about what she does and a little bit about the product today.
Yep.
So would you please tell us a little bit about your role with Quantel?
Sure. I'm a Senior Application Specialist, so I'm going to be showing off the Rio. So that's Quantel Rio on the SAM booth. Lots of new tools to show you, lots of exciting stuff for color grading and editing and effects. So.
I can't wait to see it.
Great.
Lucy, how did you get your start in this field?
So I studied graphic design and then picked up a bursary. I was really lucky, you know, got into Quantel early on in my career. And really great that I managed to learn on the job. I went through working through from graphic design when I started, a bit of editing, and then moving through to color correction and getting even more technical then as I went through that career.
So I was familiar with Quantel, but I was new to this term SAM. Can you tell us a little bit about how it's become SAM?
Yeah. So as I said, I started at Quantel, and then a year or so ago, we merged with another company, and they were called Snell. And so last IBC, when we all got together, we rebranded and we became Snell Advanced Media, which gave us the name SAM. So, yeah.
So as far as all of this wonderful color grading tool set goes, tell me a little bit about what are the features you're really here to show off at NAB this year.
Okay, well, I think the biggest feature is we're really very proud of becoming this new SAM brand. Really exciting times for us. So our roadmap has expanded. It's become a great, great product. We've still kept the Quantel name. So we're still Quantel Rio, so it's very familiar to people in the industry, but we've updated that look. So we've updated the new UI, we've given it a really nice slick look, added icons for buttons, and I want to show you that in a bit.
So here we are, and Lucy, you're going to show me a demo, yeah?
Yeah, so thank you for coming over to the SAM booth. We'll show you some of the new features that we have on the Quantel Rio. First of all, we'll start with the new interface. You'll probably be able to see here, we've updated this quite a lot. Since we've become SAM, we're really proud of our new SAM brand.
Yeah, that's sexy.
And we're trying to show that off, yeah. So just look at the new menu structures. We've not moved anything around too much, so the operators will still be able to use it. But we've got all the great color tools within here. Let's show you one of the real fast tools I like to use. What we're gonna do is just grab a quick shape within here. So I'm gonna use my panel to do that. And I'm gonna insert a new a layer and start to build up a vignette. And just draw a shape on a face. Mm-hmm. I'm gonna bring in our new tool, our very new cloud tracker. And you can see as soon as I hit that track, starts to process that effect.
That is nice.
Really, really fast. So we've sped up a lot of that information. And that's because we're not having to look at all of the data within that individual shot. So when I go into that, what we'll do is just very quickly put a grade on here. Now I'm not missing anything. I can still scale that up if I just want to, you know, do that. And very quickly I can open up any keyframe graphs and edit anything that I want to work on. And I can also make that shape really nice and soft. And there you can see that new layer applied. Great thing about this though, I hit play, it plays back in real time.
People who don't have this turnkey hardware system with the console can actually use the software alone, correct?
Yeah, absolutely, yeah. You can get just the software, build your own system. We spec that machine for you so you know you're going to get the performance out of it. And then you can add the panel. Most people like to work with a pen. Mm-hmm. Some people prefer just to work with just a mouse. That's fine too. It's entirely up to you.
Well, since I'm here for Gals and Gear, yeah, a really important part of why I wanted to speak with you today is you are a high-powered woman who has just incredible skill and expertise. Yeah, high-powered. And, you know, you're here showing off these products and, you know, I'm drawn to you and I felt like there should be more women in this field. I love doing color correction. I love doing post-production work. You clearly do too and have chosen a career in this field.
Yeah.
What would you say to other women who are interested in joining us in this industry?
Yeah.
Any advice or tips?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I was lucky I got a bursary, but I worked hard to get that bursary. And I think you have to knock on doors. I think you have to ask people.
Yes.
You have to get involved. Don't be afraid just because you're the only women out there, you know, working in that field. Just ask people. And I think they'll be willing to help every time.